and open up as Reverend Edwards gives our invocation and our mission and vision statement. And then we'll roll right into our Christmas program. What a treat we're going to have today. Amen. So Reverend Edwards, would you please open us up with our invocation and then our mission and vision statement.
Good morning, Chantilly Baptist Church. Let us bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, Father. We thank you for just getting us up again, Father, just allowing our eyes to open up once again, Father. We pray and thank you for allowing us to join together online for the service, Father. We pray that you anoint this service this morning, Father. Lift every heart this morning, Father. We pray for each and every one who's online this morning, Father. We pray for the ones who are unable to be here today, Father. We pray for the ones who are sick and shut in this morning, Father. We pray for the ones who are on the highways and byways this morning, Father. And Father, as we lift up the prayers this morning, Father, we pray for your blessings on this service, Father. We pray for our pastor today, Father, as he bring forth the word. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Amen.
We will now do our vision, starting with our mission first,
amen.
To live God's word,
to spread the gospel
of Jesus Christ to all people, and provide a welcoming place to make new disciples. We will now do our vision, reaching out to the world with the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen.
God bless you, brother. Thank you so much for that. And now we want to turn it over to our Christmas program. And as we do so, let us sit back and enjoy the wonders that the Lord has shared with us through our young people. Amen.
Verse 7 and Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6. This is what the word of God says. Luke 2:7. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Isaiah 9:6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. May the Lord of Jesus fill your hearts this Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Good morning, church family. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Lord, you deserve all the honor, all the praise, and we worship you today. You created us to worship you. We thank you for your love, grace, and mercy. Today, we demonstrate our appreciation by delivering this Christmas play. We pray that it honors you and pleases you. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus, to die for us so we can live with you eternally. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
follow the star, sign in the star, far away. Again, we hear the story, how Christ was born in glory. The angels sang, the shepherds came. The star was bright that holy night.
Amen.
He will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Let us celebrate our Savior as we gather around the tree. Let us welcome him with sounds of goodwill and harmony. Let us honor him with kindness as his holy season starts. Let us love him and make room for him within our homes and hearts. May your hearts be filled with the joy of the Lord.
Merry Christmas, everyone!
All right, Elmo.
A special blessing came our way. God sent Jesus on this Christmas day.
Amen.
With hope and joy and happiness, God sent his word this Christmas morn, so men will know Christ is born.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Jesus, Savior, Shepherd, King, Lord of all, to you we bring praise, wonder, thanks, and love for this gift from God above.
It's time to be happy, to rise and sing. Sing with the joy that Christmas brings.
It's a time to be thankful for the blessed love that came to earth from heaven above. A Christmas prayer all the year through, the Lord will bless and care for you.
I cannot buy a present for any one of you, but I have thought of something. Something that I can do. I cannot package joy, nor peace, or hope, or love. For these are from the Father, who sends them from up above. Thank you, Jesus, that you are here today. Thank you, Jesus, when you hear us pray.
Very good.
The great joy on all the earth was news of the Savior's holy birth. The greatest hope in the world today, Jesus still lives and hears us pray. If we have faith in the King of Kings, we will know the joy the Savior brings. By following his will and helping others, peace and love will join all men as brothers.
Search for peace on earth.
Praise the Lord. Amen. What a wonderful, wonderful production. We're so thankful for Staronda Garner, who leads the in these programs and her team. She puts together a wonderful team and great ideas, and our AV team is just fantastic and marvelous what they've been able to put together and to gel all of those ideas into what we just saw as a great and wonderful presentation of the talent of our youth here at Chantilly Baptist Church. What a blessing. We thank you all for that production. We also thank you for the message. And we also thank each and every one of you for being on this Zoom platform that we might be able to share together in this time of fellowship around these wonderful children of ours. As we prepare ourselves, we want to forward that we might share in a few things that we need to do on today to alert you to the fact that we're still having our Sunday school lessons. They were wonderful today as we shared Jesus' first disciples and on Wednesday at noonday and Thursday night. Of course, we're having a wonderful time in those contexts. We also want to remind you that we have been blessed to be able to share with our community what we call CBC Blesses. We have passed out 150 boxes of food. We have shared somewhere between 20 and 30 frozen turkeys. And we're gonna be doing it again on tomorrow. So we're looking forward to being out there and sharing with those in our community as we have a drive-through CBC parking lot giveaway of food in this time of difficulties that we find ourselves in this pandemic. This would be our fourth time distributing food, and I understand that there on the 19th there will be another sharing. This will be spearheaded by Deacon Full of Love and Deacon Green, also in our parking lot. Those are more specific. So God has blessed us to be able to bless others, and we're so thankful to be able to do that. We've shared masks that Sister Rita and Sister Fain actually sewed together that we are giving to those folks, as well as a bit of Christmas cheer from us, knowing that Jesus is the reason for the season. So we will be doing it again on tomorrow, and to God be the glory. I want to also remind everyone that we will be having our third Sunday service, which is a communion service, of course, and you will need to have your communion supplies for that. And we also want you to know that that we will have our watch night service also, which will be a communion service. So make sure that you have your communion supplies for those two events as we come together and share. We want to reiterate the gift for Jesus. For those who would like to give an additional monetary gift to support our CBC Capital Improvement Fundraising Ministry as we go into the end of the year, the last opportunity to share for this purpose will be on that New Year's Eve night. So please think about what the Lord would have you to do, and please provide as He gives you that opportunity to do so. Now, I want to to share a little right now, in the sense that, you know, as we are in this pandemic, we are all sensitive to the fact that many people are hurting and actually need a helping hand. And as a result, there have been, you know, some passionate ideas and appeals that have been floating around among some of the members of the congregation. But I want to make sure that we're all on the same page in getting the same information from the perspective and the viewpoint of the leadership, okay? We have a budget. We have a budget that has been enacted by a vote of the church, and we will follow that budget throughout the end of the fiscal year, which ends on December 31st at midnight. And we would be, it would be not be decent and in order if we divert or repurpose funds from the categories that the budget has prescribed that was intended to support our ministries in various ways, and that people give to in faith, then take that and do something different with it. Our trustees and our officers operate with the utmost integrity, and we can all trust that things are being done as they should be done. But on the other hand, we have and always have had a mechanism to help those in need, and it's called our Benevolent Fund. And our deacons are ready, they always have been ready to receive requests and to evaluate and provide assistance as appropriate in any way possible. If we know of anyone, if you know someone who is in need, whether they're members or not, just let your deacon know about it and they can take appropriate action from there. Members are also freely open to give to the Benevolent Fund. There's a line on your envelope for Benevolent Fund. There is e-giving line that you can give to, or you can just send in a donation mark for that purpose. And we encourage you really to do so in this time of this COVID pandemic. No new fund needs to be created in order for that to happen. We also support Western Fairfax Christian Ministries, along with other agencies and missions around the nation, as well as around the world. And we'll continue to do so. And we'll continue to partner with them to meet the needs of our community, especially with Western Fairfax Ministries here in Western Fairfax County, and through Lock Carry and various other things around the world. We are, you know, we know that they are built from the ground up in order to aid people in crises, and they are most efficient at doing that. It's not about us, but about the people being helped. We have supported these agencies, such as Lock Carry and Western Fairfax Ministry, during specific crises, such as during natural disasters, hurricanes, floods, because they are best suited to help. So we take our offerings and we send them specifically, and everybody knows what is going on. We are we've taken up special collections for that. We will continue to be good stewards of the assets that the Lord has blessed Chantilly Baptist Church with, and we will continue to show forth the utmost integrity and fiscal responsibility. Our budgeting process is underway for 2021, and the pandemic will still be around well into next year. So we will make any adjustments that need to be made through our normal process, and it will be enacted by the required vote of the church body. So everybody is on and remains on the same page as to what is being done and how we're doing it. So we give God all the praise for what he has done and what he's allowed us to do and what he continues to allow us to do. We're looking forward to that. Thank you so much for your giving. Thank you so much for your tithes and offering and special offerings. We ask and pray that the Lord will continue to bless you, especially in this holiday season, and let us also be a blessing to someone else as we go through this time of this Christmas season. Let us then now have a prayer of thanksgiving for the offerings and the tithes that have been brought in to the Chantilly Baptist Church and that we're using for our ministry. I want to ask if Deacon Fuller Love now would hear a prayer of thanksgiving for our offertory.
Praise the Lord, Pastor. Let us pray. Lord, Father, God in heaven, we thank you for so many things. In fact, Lord, we thank you for everything.
Yes.
You have been so faithful to us, Lord. Yes. And because of you, we've learned how to appreciate. We've learned how to say thanks. We learn how to show love. We learn how to be compassionate, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for your splendid example for all of us to follow. Father, we thank you for your grace, and we thank you for your mercy. And Father, for this prayer today, we are also thankful for the offerings, Father.
Yes, Lord.
For even through this pandemic time, oh yes, your blessings to Chantilly Baptist Church have grown and continue to shine. Lord, we love you. We thank you for lending your hand of protection upon us. We thank you for those who have continued to be faithful to give, Lord, for the building of your kingdom right here on this earth. As a price, yes. As a pastor has recanted earlier, that we may help one another in need, yes. That we show compassion, love, and action, that we show that we care, that we show, Lord, that we are doing thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
We help with these tithes and these offerings. So, Father, to close this prayer, how can we close a prayer, Lord, without thanking you for Jesus? How can we be so vain as to not understand that this was the greatest sacrifice, for the benefit of all mankind? And to close the prayer, Father, finally, yes, we do again. Thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us in the tithes, in the office, and the service of all those who are willing to give from their hearts. In the sweet name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Deacon Fula, for that fervent prayer, and we are indeed thankful for the Lord's blessings. Let us turn our hearts and minds now to prayer as we enter into our time of meditation and altar call. I want to ask if Reverend Worthen would prepare himself to share with us intercessory prayer as we are in this season of Advent, as we are preparing to celebrate the Lord's birth, and as our understanding that Jesus came, that he might die for our sins, and that we are indeed grateful, but also we worship him in spirit and in truth. Reverend Worthen, would you please take us to the throne of grace?
Let us pray. To the creator of heaven and of earth, to the giver and sustainer of life. Father God, we give you honor and praise for another day of life that you alone have granted us in order to worship you as well as thank you with the entirety of our being and spirit as we celebrate the birth of your Son.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we pray for your providential spirit of comfort, healing, and total restoration to fall upon the minds, bodies, and spirits of your people in Chantilly Baptist Church.
Yes, Lord.
In this country and indeed around the world, all who are ill, isolated, and disillusioned due to physical, mental, and spiritual calamities of this day. Lord, we claim it right now in the name of Jesus that it's all done. Because we believe in you.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we pause to remember and pray for the many families that have endured hardships this year, trying to figure out how to make ends meet and to keep going.
Yeah.
But Father, we recognize our strength, power, and perseverance in you that allows us as your church and your people to collectively organize and serve others to overcome disadvantages and despair, to bring hope and comfort to each other in this time of need.
Oh, yes. Yes, Lord.
Father, let us not forget those who fight in helping us to perfect this country by championing the fight for inclusion, for justice, for education, for equity, for representation, liberation, and civil rights. Father, continue to give us the mind, the will, and the strength to rally against police misconduct and brutality and to demand criminal justice reform.
Yes.
Let us continue to provide precious relief and resources during this pandemic for the uplifting of your people. Let our purpose and commitment go beyond our personal status and translate our prayers and professions of faith into actions. Let us be an inspiration to each other, Father, by having an inspired devotion to you. Lord, let us inspire hope and creativity in young people, keeping them moving with joy as we saw this morning in their hearts and spirits as we face the challenges this pandemic has brought to us and our families and our communities.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, as we approach the end of one of the worst years in American history, over 297,000 people in this country have lost their lives to the coronavirus and 3,000 expected to perish daily for the next 2 to 3 months. Our country is pleading for healing, calling for peace and to see a light at the end of this devastating tunnel. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit falls viscerally fresh upon the vaccine and the government stimulus package, so much so that it is intuitively instinctive that your hand is at work in the lives of people. Father, give us strength to work together to be a force for positive change in this country and in the world, change that embodies health, peace, justice, and freedom for all.
Yes,
Father,
yes.
I believe as Revelation 1, verses 14 through 15 describes that Jesus was a brown-skinned, woolly-haired man, a man obsessed with righteous justice. Therefore, so should we be. Father, I pray that at the end of this prayer, we will rise with a renewed commitment to continue to fight for an even more just society for all of God's people. Father, as your people, we specialize in the holy impossible, for with you, nothing is impossible. So we shall not be distracted from the work that you have ordained for us.
Oh, Lord.
In the name of Jesus, this is my prayer. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so very much, Reverend Wathan, for that wonderful, wonderful prayer. We're thankful for that today. Let us then prepare ourselves for our word for today, as the contextual scripture is read for us by Reverend Edwards. I ask that he would read from Luke, the first chapter, beginning with verse 26 and reading through verse 38. Reverend Edwards, would you please?
Starting with verse 26. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there shall be no end. Then Mary said unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth shall have also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. Verse 38. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. May the Lord bless his word for his people in the name of Jesus.
Amen. God bless you for reading that wider context. We want to have a song now from our Reverend Zion. We're looking forward to that song, and then we will preach the word of God. God bless you.
Thank you.
Amen. Jesus is excellent. His name is excellent. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're so thankful for that wonderful song of praise. God is indeed good. As we prepare to share today, our hearts and minds are now in full tilt toward the Lord and his blessings and all that he has done, all that he is doing, and all that he's going to do. Let us then prepare ourselves for a time of sharing in God's word as we focus in on a couple of verses of scripture that were read earlier by Reverend Edwards from the first chapter of Luke's gospel. If we focus in on verse 28 and 29, we see these words written. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind, what manner of salvation this should be. Amen. Praise the Lord. We want to use as a subject for that textual passage, Lessons Mary Learned. Lessons Mary Learned. Let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to share together in this time of fellowship around your word. We ask and pray that you will bless us. Give us, Lord, what you know we stand in need of individually and collectively as a church body. Let us, Lord, be inspired, Lord, to, Lord, celebrate and worship at Christmas time like we never have before, because these are times like we have not seen before. You're still God, you're still on the throne, and you're still doing things that to man would be impossible. We give you thanks and we give you praise today, and we do that in the precious and holy name of Jesus, who is the Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Lessons Mary Learned. You know, we wrapped up a series in Exodus on last Sunday as we actually talked about water at Rephidim and in Exodus 17. We saw how the children of Israel came to a place in the wilderness where they had water. They didn't have water once again. And the Lord commanded Moses to take his rod and to strike a rock there in the wilderness, and water flowed that quenched the thirst of not only all the Israelites, but their animals that they had brought with them. We looked at that as a culminating point, because that's where we started out months before, back in August. We're thankful that the Lord blessed us to be able to go through that series along with the Sunday school lessons that went along the same pathway in Exodus. And we got a full meal of Exodus in that quarter. God is blessed and he has blessed us. So these sermons really focused on the issues of the deliverance of the children of Israel from bondage in Egypt. They were brought out of Egypt by God with a mighty hand, and they were set on a road toward the promised land in Canaan, as it had been promised by God to Abraham. God keeps his promise. And as we enter into this season of Advent, we want to now turn our hearts toward the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You know, the coming of our Lord was not a new idea, but was the main idea from the beginning of Scripture, even back in the book of Genesis, the book of beginnings. We know that because if we look at Genesis 3, we see these words written because the Lord was saying to Adam and Eve, and indeed the serpent, in verse 14 and 15, "And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life." And then he says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." That happened at the cross. Amen. The prophets of the Old Testament, the prophets of the Bible, the prophets the Lord had sent prophesied the coming of the Messiah for centuries. And the coming of the Lord had been greatly anticipated for all of that time. But while this is documented in many places in the Bible and in the Scripture, we see that Isaiah said it this way. He said in Isaiah 7:14, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. And we know that Emmanuel means God with us. But after a long period of time of obedience by the Israelites, so over many centuries, the Lord shut up revelation to his chosen people. We call that the intertestamental period. And it spanned 400 years from the book of Malachi to Matthew. These were years of silence from heaven. Then we find that suddenly there was a flurry of angelic activity that began to occur as God prepared for the fulfillment of the prophecy of the incarnation of his son as the Savior and as the King who would rule forever. This was a time of swift prophetic fulfillment, an exciting time. You see, there was an angel that appeared to a man named Zacharias, who was a priest. And he told him that he and his wife Elizabeth would bear a child in their old age and in their barrenness. They had no children, and now they were stricken with old age. But Elizabeth told Zachariah, when you go in to pray in at the altar in the temple, would you please pray for a child? We know God is still able. What we see here in Luke 1, verses 11 through 13, we see how this was unfolded. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. That is, as Zacharias was in the temple offering prayers and offerings of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. Do you get that as a constant theme? Everybody that sees an angel, they don't say, hey, buddy, hey, wow, great, good to see you. No, they feared. You know, and Zacharias was no different. He feared. But the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. Our Sunday school lesson was about John, this John right here, John the Baptist, that was a forerunner of Jesus Christ. And he was the one that was in the wilderness trying to make straight the way of the Lord. But this flurry of activity continued. 6 months later, the angel Gabriel appeared to Elizabeth's cousin, Mary, with some news. But that news was, on the surface, a bit problematic. Mary was a young virgin who lived in the Galilee region of Israel in a small town called Nazareth. However, this young lady was betrothed to be married to a man named Joseph, who was a carpenter in that town. You know, both were poor, but both were well-respected and devout believers in God. And although they were poor peasant people, the genealogies given in the Gospels of both Matthew and Luke show that they were both of the kingly line of David. You see, as we look at Luke, the first chapter, 26 through 27, this is what the angel said. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. Let's take a minute and look at this issue of betrothal. Betrothal is a lot different than what we view as an engagement to be married today. Betrothal was such a commitment toward marriage that to break off a betrothal, one would need to get a formal divorce. That's how serious it was. You could not just break up and go your separate ways. I mean, it was not as trivial as that. You know, down in Mississippi, you know, it would say the shotgun was sitting by the side of the door. You know, you didn't just turn and walk away. The message that the angel Gabriel then brought to Mary was one that would cause her to have to learn a new and difficult lesson, or indeed a series of lessons. Lessons that applied to her, but they also apply to us today. What lessons did Mary need to learn as she tried to get her head around what the angel Gabriel had brought her? Well, that brings me to my first point. She had to learn the lesson that God's plans are eternal. We need to learn that lesson too. His plans are eternal. Look at what it says in verse 23. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom, there shall be no end. That's what the angel Gabriel told Mary. Mary undoubtedly had many plans for her life. You know, most people have plans for their life, you know, as they go into adulthood. You know, they have thoughts about how their life should go and what they should do and how they should do it. You know, like many young women then, Mary had the dream that she would hope to be fulfilled in her future. She hoped for someday to marry a wonderful, faithful, respectable, hardworking man. She dreamed of the blessings of motherhood and of a warm home and a family of her own. She had these dreams. She thought about how maybe one of her children may grow up to be a great success and be highly regarded in society. You know, she had dreams like that. People have those kinds of dreams today. These were typical dreams and occur, you know, many times in many lives. But Gabriel brought Mary a surprising message, one that would make her, would kind of take her a while to get her head around, right? And the message started out pretty good. I mean, it really did, you know, because Gabriel, what was the first thing he said? He told Mary that she had been found of favor with God. Let's look at what he said in verse 28. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Boy, that sounds pretty good. Hallelujah. Amen. She's like, I can deal with that. That really is all right. In fact, he goes on in verse 30, says, And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. So far, so good. No lessons to be learned, really. But he keeps on talking. And now we've got some other things. There are things that got a little bit problematic. He told her that she would conceive before she would marry, and even while she was still a virgin. Look at what he said in verse 31. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. And not only that, but that she would bear a son and that son would be the Son of the Highest, the Son of God, and would be king after his father David. Wow, that is something to wrap your head around. Amen. Look at what it says in verse 32. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. Wow. And moreover, he would be king not for a little while, but he would reign forever. Look at what he goes on to say in verse 33. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Mary had to learn the lesson that God works in the realm of forever. God works in the realm of eternality. Mary could only understand the temporary. In our minds, we can only see and understand those things that are here in the world and according to time. But she needed to learn that God's word is eternal and that his word has eternal significance. We should live our lives then understanding that we serve a forever God. We serve an eternal God. We serve a God that is the great I am. Isaiah said it like this in Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. And he ends that section with the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Not might, you know, but will perform this. We see this as definite that God will do this as the time goes forward. You know, that brings me to my next point that Mary had to learn. And that was that God's promises are unfailing. God's promises are unfailing. You know, his promises are going to come. They're going to happen. They don't happen on our time. It happens on his time. And he knows when the fullness of time comes. Look at verse 32 through 33 again. He said, he shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end, which is a requote of Isaiah. You know, it is without a shadow of a doubt that Mary was familiar with these words of prophecy and the promise of the coming Messiah. Mary understood that. She knew that, you know, but she never thought that she might be the one that would be the object in this particular process. In fact, for generations in Israel, young women had dreamed of being the mother of the coming Messiah. That would be the penultimate blessing on any woman in Israel. The Jews also longed for the time that God would send that anointed one, which means the Messiah, to rule on the throne of David and to deliver them from the rule of strangers. In that time, it was the Roman Empire. They knew from the verses I read earlier that the Messiah would be born of a virgin and not of a man and woman. They knew that because, as we read again, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. But not only that, they knew where the prophesied birth would occur. Look at Micah 5, verse 2. For thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been from of old, from everlasting. In other words, the person that will be incarnate, the person that will come, that would not be their beginning, but they would be incarnate because they were forever and of old. And that can only speak of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But centuries had passed, and these promises had not been fulfilled as yet. And under the captivity of the Roman Empire, it seemed that it was not going to happen anytime soon. However, Gabriel is bringing the good news that revealed that the time was now at hand for the fulfillment of the prophecy that the Lord had given through his prophets in the Old Testament and his promise to Abraham. Gabriel was alerting Mary to the fact that she would be the one that would give birth to the promised Messiah, the anointed Son of God. What great news, but what a magnificent thing it is to have to get your head wrapped around as a young lady in that time. She had to learn those lessons that we had before, but you know what? She had to learn another lesson. First of all, she had to learn that God's plan was eternal. She had to learn that God's promises were unfailing. But the last thing she had to learn was that God's power is unlimited. God's power is unlimited. Look at what Gabriel said to her, you know, in response to her questions about, hey, you know, I don't get it. Here's what he said. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. You know, Mary wanted to know just like we would, and just like, you know, so don't beat Mary up too much, right? She wanted to know how these things could come to pass. Let's see how she said that. Then Mary said unto the angel, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? How can this possibly happen? You know, Mary said, this is biologically impossible. This defies biology 101. You know, when women in the past have claimed this, you know, everybody knew that there was something funny going on, right? Yeah, well, you know, I don't know, you know, how, you know, I ended up this way. You know, I never ran around, you know, yeah, sure, right. Right? Mary was a devout and blameless woman. And she was one of great integrity, truly a virgin and truly favorite of God. But she needed to learn another lesson because she was very confused at this point. Gabriel had to share with her a lesson not on biology 101, but on God 101. Sometimes we need to go back to the primary grade to understand who God is and what he's able to do. With God, nothing is impossible. You know, the Holy Spirit will do the impossible, as Gabriel said in verse 35. It says, and an angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow shout of thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. In other words, he said to Mary, you know what? I know you know biology, and I know that you made an A in biology 101. I know you got all that wrapped down. I know you got it all straight, but let me tell you something. God, if God can make man out of dirt, he can certainly create his son in your womb. And that is exactly what he did. You see, as we look further, God had already proven his power to his cousin, to her cousin Elizabeth. So that should have been a sign to her that God is able. Let's go on a little bit further and look at verse 38. And it says, and behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, Gabriel said, she hath also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. He said, you know what? If you want to know what God can do, go visit your cousin Elizabeth. You know how old she is. You know she's never had children, she and Zacharias. You know that that would probably be impossible with man right now. But you go up there and visit her and see what God can do. Amen? So with God, all things are possible. What good news that is for troubled times for us today. With God, nothing shall be impossible. It doesn't matter what's going on around us. It doesn't matter what the circumstances are. It doesn't matter what's happening in this day and age. You know, this COVID-19 pandemic is on track to take over 300,000 lives by the end of the year 2020, and that's just 3 weeks away. People are dying at a rate of 1,000 to 3,000 per day. We have 100,000 more total deaths than Brazil, India, or Mexico by 100,000 deaths. Almost 16 million have been tested positive. And that's only a fraction of those who probably have been infected. You know, you can only detect those that you test, and we ain't tested everybody yet. So then praise God that he has allowed scientists to produce a vaccine that is here and that is ready to be rolled out here in the United States on tomorrow. But you know what? It's going to be well on into the year before it's widely distributed and before many people can actually get the vaccine. But in the meantime, with God, everything is possible. He is able to do exceeding abundantly above anything that we can possibly ask or think, and we can do what the Lord has called for us to do and know that everything is going to be all right. What a faith builder this is in this time. It's a faith builder for our prayer. What Mary learned is what we need to learn in days like these and ages like this. These lessons are seen throughout the Gospels. Reiterate this over and over again, that God's plans are eternal. The cross was not an event, but an eternal landmark. God's promises are unfailing. You know, the resurrection and the second coming are assured. God's power is unlimited. New birth is available to the most wretched sinner, and can save whosoever will can receive the free gift of salvation. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is why I call on you to learn these lessons that Mary had to learn for yourself and for myself, to remind ourselves that God's love for you and for me is eternal, and that God's promises to you and to me are unfailing, and that God's power to save us is unlimited and it is eternal. We can trust the Lord. We can bless his holy name. We can worship him in spirit and truth because we serve a God that is able. He can do everything but fail. And he is in the world today, and the Christ child that was born of the Virgin Mary is available to whosoever will call upon his name and receive his free gift of salvation. You should receive Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord today without delay. If you have never accepted, if you've never called upon his name, if you've never turned your life over to him, this is the time that you ought to do so. You need to trust him to care for the problems that you have, that you're running into, that you have had in the past, and that you foresee in the future. You know, the trouble in your life, you need to hand it over to the Lord. And if you're not having trouble, just hold on. You'll see some pretty soon. Amen. But God is able. He said, if you today would believe, if you would turn your heart over to him, believe and trust him as Lord and Savior, pray a simple prayer. Lord, I need you in my life. I need you to forgive all of my sins. And I understand that you paid for my sins on the cross. All have sinned and come short of your glory. And Lord, I'm calling on your holy name, and I ask you to come into my life and be my Savior. If you can pray a simple prayer and really believe from the depths of your heart that it is true, you can be saved, and the Lord will come in, and your life will never be the same again. Let this Christmas be like no other Christmas if you have never accepted Jesus Christ, because then you are really understanding what the Lord has done. We're so thankful for the opportunity to be able to share. And the Lord had already worked out and made a way for us to continue to worship together in spirit and in truth. And we thank the Lord today. We bless his holy name, for his mercy endureth forever. God is so good, and we're so thankful for each and every one of you. So if you are here today and you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, just write in the chat box your name and some contact information that we can get with you and pray with you and share with you, that you might be assured of your salvation, that you be ready to move ahead in your Christian life. So all of us others that are on, we just thank you for being a part of our service today. We ask and pray for our virtual members from around the country. We know that the Lord is blessing us through you by your presence and sharing with us. We're thankful for all of that. And we ask and pray the Lord's blessing as we prepare next Sunday for our communion service. Please pick up your communion supplies and also an extra one for the end of the year for our New Year's Eve service, our watch night service. I've already mailed out those to many of our virtual members that should be receiving that pretty soon. So to God be the glory. We give God all thanks and praise. Let us close out with a benediction and go into our parking lot. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to share together in your word. We thank you, Lord, for the lessons that Mary learned, that they are exactly the lessons that we ought to learn each and every day, and know that you're able to do exceeding abundantly. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, that was born incarnate on that first Christmas morning. We know that his existence didn't start then, but that he is eternal from eternity to eternity. We give you thanks and we bless your holy name. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power both now, henceforth, and forever. Let us all say together, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're so thankful for each and every one of you. We pray that you will have a wonderful week. We have entered then the parking lot. We ask that you would unmute yourselves and say good morning to anyone that you would like to.